At the same time, as Anna was baking the cookies, Julie finally finishes dragging Emily to the pool. Without a single word, Julie walks the pool area, chains included, with a type of rock that looks almost exactly like the floor tile. Now it's our training spot where no one, except crazy people, will come by. Julie winks cheerfully. But, Julie, is it April? We are going to have a real short time before people will start wanting to use this area for swimming. Well, not for us. I just happened to read something today that this pool is going to be discontinued this year. Emily just shrugs. Why they decided to cut something that everyone loved at the university was beyond both of them. But it's a golden opportunity for the two of them. Well, that brings us to our second matter. Is it pool day or freeform time? Emily jokingly asks. Julie suddenly makes a small boulder appear on her hand and begins throwing it up with one hand. You know what I wanna do, right? Emily begins smiling pretty hard and thinks she does as well. Unfortunately for Emily, it was not a fight or getting boulders out of the water. Julie wanted to slam jam, and by God, she was going to use this opportunity and play a game of basketball with Emily. Being a closet athlete, she always used to watch sports entertainment on the TV when she wasn't enjoying them, and always used to show up to her school's volleyball games. What? You want me to play basketball with you? Do you even realize my heart can't keep up with sports anymore? I don't even know what basketball is. Emily nervously yells, as Julie is busy making the ring out of magic limestone. Even the different lines on the floor were made. Don't worry, you'll love it. Emily got profusely tired and sweaty after the first quarter, and considering they didn't bring any gym clothes, her school uniform is going to need washing. Meanwhile, Julie was living it up, constantly shooting threes, while Emily couldn't keep up. For two reasons. Both of those reasons occurred when Emily accidentally grabbed Julie's board trying to guard her. She had not a clue on how to play defense, and she was trying really hard to not grab a private part. Oh my Emily, in your attempt to guard me, you have grabbed a hold of my posterior by accident. She says in a menacing tone for a moment. So how do you rate how my panties feel? Julie, that's utterly weird for you to ask that right now. I'm asking because I think I need a new pair. Emily looks at her panties again, only to find that Emily's sweaty hand had made a stain in her best friend's clothes. Oh no Julie Chen, I'm sorry. Don't worry about it. If I was concerned about clothing more than improving ourselves, we would've just gone home with Ano Chen. Both of them realize something in unison and spurt out a wave that's practically every day for us. Then they start laughing again until Emily stops laughing for a moment. Wait, this basketball is our training for today? Well yes. Emily looks at Julie funny for a moment, before Julie catches on. Then Julie points up in the air, kinda frustrated. Not everything is a battle manga where training is either lifting weights, going on magical journeys, or fighting one another. We have to work out in a healthy and balanced fashion. So the boards, the score, the floor, everything is literally just you training yourself, while finding an excuse to torment me? Emily looks around while saying this. Actually no. It has multiple other purposes. It'll help you move faster, or longer, all without the use of magic. They look at the time by climbing over the walls and seeing the clock in place. They had done 2 hours worth of training, Julie had won by a landslide, and it was 8. However, immediately upon Julie trying to jump back down, she had a huge drain of energy to the point where she couldn't stand, let alone move with anything but the crawl. Her breathing was also extremely heavy. Julie, all that magic using messed you up this badly? She struggles to stand Julie up and get her bang onto her, having been drained herself. Halfway back to the house, Julie starts speaking. You know, it's been a while since you had to carry me somewhere like this. God, I feel like it happened just yesterday. Julie gives the most of a smile she can at this current moment. Yeah, I know I'm not an athlete at you, but lifting someone as healthy as you is kinda tough. Emily says, you're going to say something about doing it anyway, if it's for your best friend. Julie says, to which Emily nods. Of course you would. I love being with you. Even if you sweat all over the place when we do endurance sports. And you're my savior. Emily smiles, before starting a joke. I mean, we share the same locker room and visit each other all the time. Isn't sweating together and enjoying the smell of it fun? I guess smelling fresh is our favorite thing to do. They both laugh on their way home. What they see when they come back are a bit of burned grass, the magic book being open, and the floor being notably tidy. They also smell the fresh scent of strawberry cookies. All we look at, how nice Ano Chen is, leaving us with something sweet to eat. Julie exclaims, before they both chow down on a cookie each. They taste, well, okay. Not as good as a chef, but hey, it's the thought that counts. Once they finish, Emily uses the washing machine to make her uniform smell fresh, as well as her undies. She might as well go to the bathroom and clean herself off after all that. A shower might be a great idea for right now. Julie. I'll be a moment, I'm going to take a shower. That's alright. I was planning to watch some TV to relax myself. Emily walks into her bathroom, modestly big for a house. Before she goes into the shower, however, she looks at herself in the mirror and cups her breasts while examining them. Geez, have they grown this big already? It's hard enough finding pairs that'll fit. Being plus size sure is annoying. But she can't exactly do something about it. So she stuffs it off and begins to take a shower. She does a good job of washing herself with her soap, which is her favorite scent, lavender. After washing long enough, she begins to hum a soft tune to herself. A tune of a song she loved, since many years ago. It's soothing to her. She continues, before she notices a second voice humming along. She stops, and so does the voice. Then she starts humming again, and not long after, the other humming continues. Emily doesn't bother to stop this time, and the other voice humming starts to actually sing the lyrics to the song from the bathtub. Actually, now that Emily remembers, she never checked if the tub was empty or not. She turns toward the tub and notices Otto just enjoying her tub. It was filled with bubbles, and it seemed like Otto had been there for a while. Hello Emily-sama. Sorry about that, I didn't want to disturb you, but I couldn't help myself. She chuckles, while she explains why she's there. Yeah, the learning kinda went bad. I spent forever trying to make one fire connect to another fire like a cable, and I couldn't do it. Don't worry about it, Otto. We all struggle a little sometimes, like when I had to carry Julie all the way here. Wait, you guys worked that hard at the pool? Otto suddenly bounces a bit in surprise. Of course. It was her idea after all. Otto then tells Emily about how she tried to go to bed, but it didn't work out and how having a bath would be the solution. So, cup talks are a no-no? Otto asks. Yeah, they are no-no. They both remain there, unable to find anything to talk about, until Emily finishes her shower and leaves. Otto decides to get out 5 minutes later, where she then puts on her pajamas and attempts to sleep again. Julie ends up joining her an hour later, and they hug each other like teddy bears for comfort. Finally, Emily comes into bed, all of them softly asleep. The next school day arrives, and everyone goes. The day is practically a normal day, other than Otto delivering her platter of cookies to the substitute teacher. However, this normality ends when Otto gets into the room for detention. This is someone Otto's never really seen before. A hair color she hasn't seen before either. Pardon me, young student. I could not make it in time yesterday, for I have arrived here straight from Italy. I am Mr. Cephalou, and you can ask me anything. It's a rather odd sight, and a surprise. The teacher almost looks young enough to be a student, and is practically really thin, but he sports this gentlemanly attitude that people just can't resist. Hello Mr. Cephalou, I am Otto Ochino, and I'm very happy to meet you. Oh, you already are excited for today's detention, aren't we? Well, I must assist you in any way I possibly can. He insists, to which Otto had no real reason to not let him. Japanese, Dave, I have read through your documents, and it seems like the teacher who sent you here must have been a spoiled sport. Fear not, for I will have you understand everything. He, very clearly, had only an apprentice level Japanese writing skill, but he told everything so well, and so fluidly, like it flowed on, down a stream. Otto had the concept down pat, and had no troubles comprehending it. Look Mr. Cephalou, I can write really great now. You're a fantastic teacher. Well, I would say that I am a teacher, but would I say I am anywhere close to what you say I am? Not so much. I am but one man in a lake of many other educators. It turned out Otto finished early, so she caught up on her other subjects rather fast. She massively thanked Mr. Cephalou as she exited, and even offered him cookies. I'm afraid I cannot have such a scrumptious biscuit from a student. But you can dine on one in my honor, if you wish. He bows, then closes the door. Otto was extremely happy. Not only did she find a teacher that was practically her type, the practical type, but she only has one subject she is behind in now. Which, with the homework done, she can finally start training for real. She rushes on over to the school pool, and encounters her friends in competitive swimsuits, and with the pool full. Oh, Otto. I see you have an excited look on your face. Tell us what happened. Julie says. Well, I met this teacher in detention and he's, like, super amazing. He'll break things down in language you can understand and smack knowledge into your head just like that. Wow. That's actually really neat. I never knew the detention teacher was that good. What's his name? Emily smiles and asks. His name's Mr. Cephalou, and he has blue hair, Otto tries to go on, but Julie stops her. Otto, this might seem really weird. But, don't come to school tomorrow, Friday, or Monday. Julie's face suddenly begins to be serious. Wait, what? Why? Otto wonders, as she had been enjoying it these past 2 days. Julie struggles to think of a reason for her to not come, but Emily interjects with a suggestion. You can train all day, and get better even faster with your magic. Emily excitedly says. But my attendance record is important, and I don't wanna miss out on the homework either. Don't worry. We'll bring the homework home with us, for you to do. Donna then looks at the pool and wonders what it's for. Oh, are you guys planning on racing or swimming around?
Yeah, that's exactly what we're doing.
Oh, okay. I think I'll go back home and try to figure out how to chain link. Donna runs home, almost as fast as when she came. However, some order wizards also got the same idea and jumped Donna while she was in a hurry.
You know, by chain link, I didn't mean you guys trying to take me hostage.
Donna says, as she throws aside her uniform, skirt and all, and reveals she had her fighting bikini on the whole time, striking a magical girl pose. This pretty flame will be your justice. She came up with that on the fly, and it was corny, but it worked in her head. All five suddenly start dashing towards Anno, as they try to defeat her, but she throws a fireball up to distract them, and then rushes into, very sloppily, take them out without injuring them. Unfortunately, her first attempt was just pushing one of them over, and they managed to make her lose her balance with one sweet kick. She catches herself and kicks one of them directly in the face by accident, knocking one of them out. She, playfully, does a fighting stance, before they approach her. Thing is, they didn't notice she laid flame mines when she tripped by pressing too hard, and so two of them suffered some burn damage and couldn't fight anymore. The final two, however, managed to out hand-to-hand the extremely inexperienced Donna and managed to knock her down. She thinks she's done for, and begins praying for her friends to be alright, but the fireball she threw earlier gets a nearby street lamp, and, by some miracle, lands directly onto the last two. Unable to really tie them up, she decided to just sit there, after she called the police, until they came and arrested the assailants. Of course, they gave Anno a ticket for destroying public property, but she expected it. She finally gets back home at 7:05, which then she puts on her pajamas and begins making herself, and her friends, dinner. This time nice Johnny cakes. However, from that fight from earlier, she figured out some of the reason why chain linking was so hard. Pressing that hard only lays dormant flames in one spot. Well, at least she knows how to lay flame mines down now. She spends her time waiting for the Johnny Cakes to finish baking simply trying to chain link, but no progress has been made at all. However, she is much more confident that she'll get it down eventually. Donna eats her Johnny Cake, decides to set the radio straight to the computer-generated dance music channel, and begins dancing to herself. She enjoys this very much and gets extremely into it. While all of this is going for Anno, Julie and Emily, very secretly, are using the pool water to simulate fighting in Heinz Fog, being that there's barely any usable oxygen in water. Not to mention Emily can't use her flames in this water, so it's a handicap in Julie's favor. THW to swim fight rather well, even though it takes a lot more energy to do it in there. They come up for air in between bouts, due to none of them being able to manage being underwear for more than a minute. But then, all of a sudden, Emily gets an idea, and elevates herself enough to where the flames would actually work, and jet propel her up enough to turn around and use a technique she had been thinking of doing. In their old fury blanket, she says, as she sears the entire water area to actually boil and leave Julie extremely impressed. You know, that's a whole other level of brilliant. Using the temperature of the flames to boil the water. Julie says, I got a feeling that it won't be this easy, as someone skilled with magic, as Hein is. Her fog is likely extremely dense. Emily theorizes. So, I'd say we only do that if we run out of options. Like, if I'm not able to get her in the fog, I guess. They eventually refill the pool, although it takes a bit. They continue fighting inside the water to improve their bodies, and just in case something like Heim's ability comes up again. Eventually, they get tired and climb out of the pool, soaking wet. Julie then proceeds to look at Emily's very plump waist from afar and examine it. You know, boys would kill to have a girlfriend with your posture, as unhealthy as it is. Well, if you're saying that, Julie, I'm very glad the school has a zero harassment tolerance rule. I don't know, but I deal with jocks wanting my body. So, you know, while our magic book has this thing where people who love each other have their magic become more plentiful and stronger, Julie suddenly says, well, of course. You want to know why me and Anno thought that meant sexual contact at first? Emily chuckles while saying this. Truth is, I kind of gave her the idea. I met a high libido that day, and I couldn't shake it off my head. So Anno happened to be my excuse to screw, and that just so happened to reveal the book. Julie gets visibly upset over this, very much so. Geez, you have to stop being a bad role model for people younger than you. Not to say it didn't feel good when me and Anno did it, but it's a whole other story if you teach her that behavior. Emily admits defeat on this one. Normally she'd argue, but Julie's right this time. Yeah, after we both figured out loving each other could be anything friendly directly to other users of the book, we never did that again. But do us having these fun moments together also power up Anno, or is it just between the two of us? Julie asks Emily a very important question. None of us really know at all. I mean, we aren't magic experts or anything.